So many good questions this week. Make sure that you ask them again next week if we didn't get to some of them, because we really got so many questions, which is awesome, and I hate that we don't get to answer them.
We counted over 80 before we started today.
From ChrisLynn12 on Instagram, how do you get your dogs to stop jumping and counter surfing? We actually talked about this in our last Yawa video, but just a quick recap. Place training is a huge part of managing some of those behaviors. If your dog's on a dog bed, they can't be counter surfing. Second of all, don't video it. If it happens, correct it when it happens so that timing is perfect and important, so that you make the correction when the behavior that isn't wanted happens. And then ultimately you can make the counter an uncomfortable place, whether that's utilizing an e-collar properly or setting something up like mouse traps on the counter, because that timing is gonna be perfect. Your dog jumps up, sets up a mouse trap, startles themselves and goes, ugh, I don't wanna do that again, and just makes the counter not an enjoyable place to be.
And typically startles themselves. Mouse traps are awesome, they snap. They usually, I would say most of the time, do not even snap the dog, it just startles them, so.
Yes.
Alvin Gold, we have a one-year-old GSP. Is excessive shedding normal? GSPs shed, I will tell you that.
We sweep up quite a bit of dog hair, but we also have a lot of dogs. Now, if there's an excessive amount of shedding.
What is excessive shedding?
Things that you can evaluate is what type of dog food they're on, how many baths they're getting, time of year. So it just truly depends on what exactly is going on. And if you think that it's way more shedding than should be happening, you can make some adjustments somewhere and see if that helps.
So Alan, throw it in the comments below. Give us a little more information about that so that we can help you better. Next.
From JBirthIssel102, what's your opinion on beeping tracking collars? Do they scare wild birds? No.
No.
Our dogs run with beeper collars all hunting season long. Never flushes a bird, scares a bird. Dogs sometimes will overpressure birds, and that's what actually will push them up. But a dog that locks up solid on point, their beeper starts going off, birds are still there, we go in and flush them. So, doesn't cause a problem for us.
Andrew Haddock on Facebook. What do you do different in training for sensitive / timid personalities? Okay, so I'm gonna tell you, short answer is we do nothing different. Our plan is to work with dogs on their speed and their level. And when we use pressure or collars or anything else, we use the lowest amount of pressure possible. So it's whatever that individual dog needs. So the process is the same. We teach with positive reinforcement. We use negative reinforcement to develop consistency or build consistency in a behavior that they already know. That process is exactly the same for a tough dog versus a timid dog. The biggest difference with the tough and the timid dogs are when you get to collar conditioning, usually the tough dog uses a little more collar, the timid dog or the softer dog uses a little less collar. The teaching part with positive reinforcement is all the same. Great question.
Next question from Laura Bell 22 on Instagram. I'm getting my first GSP puppy this summer. What is your best advice for me when training? Well, I'll refer back to our other question. Socialization is hugely important, but because you didn't limit me to one thing, I'm also gonna say patience. Patience is your friend when it comes to any training with dogs, puppies, anything like that, because they're gonna make mistakes and you need to be patient and be more of a mindset of you're wanting to help them meet these goals and not break them or force them into doing those things. So socialization and patience.
Jen F. Matthews, will you do a clinic to work with people training their own dogs for NAVDA? I was disappointed I wasn't free to be available to come up for your with my pup, the one you held in September. Yeah, I think we're gonna plan on doing anywhere between 3 and 4 seminars this year. If we can work them into the schedule, they will show up on social media, yes, on our newsletter, yes, and then you sign up on our online store. They'll be available as an item, so you can register you and your dog for a spot right there. Once they're available to sign up for, they will be there.
Seth O'Neill from Instagram, most difficult thing about being pro dog trainers?
Ooh. I'm going to say the hardest part for me about being a pro dog trainer is when I have to tell somebody that their dog doesn't meet their expectations. It's a hard conversation to have, to say, you want to be here, your dog is struggling a little bit, and realistically, we're gonna be here.
Not everyone's dog is NFL player.
Yeah, not every kid's gonna make the NBA or NFL or be a professional athlete. And the same thing happens with dogs. I mean, now granted, we're gonna take dogs to the highest level of their capabilities, and for the average person, rarely do we run into a dog that doesn't meet expectations. But if you have extremely high goals of testing and trialing and titles and all this stuff, and we go, it's gonna be more than what they can take, it's a hard conversation to have. So.
Yes. The most difficult thing about being pro dog trainers is probably that our personal dogs get put on the back burner more often than we would like, just because we are professionals that are getting paid to train other people's dogs. Therefore, those dogs become the priority. Our dogs sometimes get pushed to the back burner. They still get plenty of out time and fun time, but training time sometimes gets a little remiss.
They're the first ones to miss training if it has to happen.
So we still accomplish great things with our dogs, but sometimes it would be nice to have a little more time with them.
Great question. Here's another Instagram question. At what age can I start using the EasyLead with my puppy? If you don't know what an easy lead is, it's our lead that is available on our website, designed to help stop pulling in as short amount of time as 10 minutes. You can watch some of the sessions where we actually take dogs from pulling wild banshees to not pulling at all on our easy lead. So what age we recommend, usually when the dog is bold and confident, either on leash pulling a lot or confident running around the field. That age is typically 5 to 6 months for the average short hair and most hunting dogs in general. Five to six months.
And I'm just gonna put a caveat in there. It does depend on your ultimate goals for your dog. Ethan and I make the assumption a lot of times that everybody's dog is a hunting dog. That's not always the case. You might just have a great adventure dog or family dog that is also a sporting breed or not a sporting breed, and you're asking about that. And my recommendation would be, if you've got a hunting dog, you're gonna wanna see, like Ethan was saying, a bold, confident, and independent search in the field where they're not looking to you constantly for direction and how they're supposed to be working that field, because you're, like we talked about in a previous question, the most important tool and best tool that you have in the field is your dog's nose. Well, if they're constantly in this little 10-foot circle and looking to you for direction, they're not out actively hunting. And we want to see that before we put so much emphasis on healing that they don't actually feel comfortable leaving our side, even when we get into the field. UN Guided Fly. Can't find a video of the intro to gunfire on your YouTube channel? We'll put it in the description because we have multiple videos on gunfire and bird introductions. SunnysideUp_OKC. How do I start and implement calm expectations? Good question. We like to say calm hands make a calm dog. So interacting with your puppy or dog calmly makes them think that they don't have to act like a wild hooligan to get your attention and get your affection. So if they're sitting or standing and not jumping up on you, calmly interacting with them. Dogs feed off of your energy really easily. So if you get all wild and ooh, 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 and so excited with them, that's what they're gonna do. Think about it when you go to the vet and all of the vet techs act like idiots with your dogs.
Yeah.
Then your dog also acts like an idiot. So if you can try and interact with them calmly, that would help start implementing calm expectations. We also like to say anything that your dog's doing, they're conditioning themselves to. So if they jump up on you and you pet them, they're gonna think, oh, I jump up, I get petted. And they're gonna start conditioning themselves that that's how they think that they get attention. Or any behavior that they're repetitively doing, if it's something you don't want, nip that in the bud, because otherwise they're going to condition themselves to that. As well as, I would say, develop behaviors in your dog you're going to want to see as an adult. We make excuses for puppies a lot of times. Oh, they're just a puppy. Oh, they're just a puppy. And at 2 years old, you have a wild monster that's no longer a puppy, but you've made excuses for them and haven't developed proper behaviors. So if you don't want your adult dog jumping up and standing on the counters, shouldn't let your puppy do it. If you don't want your adult dog on the furniture, shouldn't let your puppy do it. Things like that. But because you said it was a two-part question, here's part two. How do I get my pups to all stay quiet in their kennels when with other dogs? Again, might need a little clarification, but if I'm making an assumption, you've got other dogs maybe out and your dogs are being noisy, well, they just want to be part of the activity. And in the kennel, we deal with this
expectation.
Yep, and in the kennel, we deal with this a lot because other dogs have to watch training sessions. They want to be a part of it, especially these types of sporting breeds. They're very affectionate, very family oriented. They want to be part of everything. So they don't want to watch. Yes, you can use bark collars to help with that, but also giving those dogs time and attention as well should help minimize the noise.
I've got two more and then we're gonna call it. That's it for this time. So Jesse McCullough says, what kind of off-season training are you doing? This is a forethinker here, wanting to prepare for next season, and this season is just maybe at the end, depending on where you live. Do you take notes during the season to work on those mistakes made during hunting season? Mental notes, that's a great question. My dog has just completed his first hunting season where we retrieved 32 birds. That's an awesome number. I worked all year on basic commands, retrieving, and patience. I think he's done very well for a rookie, but now what do we do? So I need some more information here. You said retrieve 32 birds. I'm assuming maybe retriever duck hunting, but I know some duck seasons are still open. The biggest thing is, yes, we do make notes, typically mental notes, but those kind of run pretty consistently. If I've got a young dog, I know after we finish hunting season, we're gonna move into some more formal stuff. If I've got a seasoned dog, again, I've already taught them everything, and so it's just refreshers. We go back to training situations and we have all of the expectations. So it would really depend on exactly where you're at with training. So please.
And your ultimate goals. Like if you're planning on doing advanced levels of testing, off season's when you start working on those goals. But for example, Quest, she's a young dog.
Yep.
We finished hunting season. Next plan for her is to start formal retrieving work.
Yes. That would be the only thing that I struggled with this year. There were a few birds, like some of them get retrieved really well to hand, some of them get dropped just a little bit short, and that would be, we would say, that would be her weak point. That's what we need to be working on this season. She's backing, she's steady, she's doing all the other things awesome. She just needs a little bit of work to finish up that retrieving. So it's a great question. Please, Jesse, throw in the comments below kind of a little more information so that we can help you with that. And the last, but not least, Justin Carr. Group or private lessons available? Yes, we did kind of mention that, but it was mostly about the
seminars
yep. that we're doing. We do also private or one-on-one training sessions.
We call them consults typically.
Absolutely. All you got to do is reach out to us. Our phone numbers and contact information are on our website, standingstonekennels.com, and we will be happy to set up on your schedule a great time to work one-on-one with you and your dog.
And just something else that you might be asking with that question is maybe you're talking about setting up a group type of event for a club or a dog training group that you work with, and you want us to come out and do things with you at your location. We do that as well.
If you're in Hawaii, we definitely do that.
We want to go to Hawaii really bad, so.
Hey guys, this is the end of You Ask, We Answered, and we appreciate all of you for throwing comments and questions out there for us. We'll be doing this again next week. Please, if we didn't get to your questions, throw them back up there, and we will try next week to hit those out.
Yeah, because it was an overwhelming number of questions, so.
I'm the guy with the pink gun.
And I'm Kat the dog trainer.
Thanks guys, we'll see you next week.